One, two, three.
Yes.
One, two, three. No. One, two, three. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. May I have your attention? Before we begin this meeting, we ask that everybody silence your cell phones. The Fort Bend ISD Board of Trustees meeting is an open meeting for the public to observe the board conducting district business. Therefore, audience members may address the board during the designated audience items section on the agenda. If you have any printed materials you want to give to the board members, you must provide them to the board secretary, Jane Kaiser, or to me, and we'll provide them to the board. We also ask the members of the audience be respectful of others and remain quiet during the meeting so that everyone's able to hear the proceedings. For your convenience, microphones have been provided on both sides of the boardroom. Please speak directly into the microphone if you're asked to answer a question or address the board during the meeting. Thank you.
Thank you, Officer Ontiveros. This meeting is hereby called to order. The time is 6:05 p.m. We have the presence of a quorum, and the meeting has been duly called, and notice of the meeting has been posted for the time and manner required by law. We're going to start with our pledges of allegiance. If I can have everyone please stand and then remain standing for a silent invocation.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Honor the Texas flag. I pledge allegiance to thee, Texas, one state under God, one indivisible.
Please remain standing for a silent invocation. Please be seated. We'll start with recognitions this evening. Dr. Dupree?
Yes, ma'am. If the board would join me in front of the dais, we have some very special recognitions tonight.
Dr. Dupree, thank you. We're so proud to recognize our board members tonight. And to help us do that, we would like to introduce and recognize some students and staff members. First, the pledges of allegiance were led by Sullivan Elementary students whose artwork has been selected to be showcased as gifts for Fort Bend ISD Board of Trustees for their service to our district. You will meet them shortly, but let's just give them a round of applause. The district is pleased to recognize the Fort Bend ISD Board of Trustees during School Board Recognition Month. School Board Recognition Month is observed in Texas each January to build awareness among our citizens about the important and vital role that an elected board of education plays in our society. Fort Bend ISD is proud to recognize and express its sincere appreciation to the members of our Board of Trustees, seven individuals who have a strong, unyielding commitment to doing what is best for the children in our district. By contributing countless hours of their time, our board members work to ensure that our educational system is governed in the most effective and efficient manner possible with the best interests of our students at heart. Please join us in recognizing Fort Bend ISD Board of Trustees, Kristen Tassan, President. Jason Burdine, Vice President. Maddie Helliger, Secretary. Board members K.P. George, Grail James, and Dave Rosenthal. And Jim Rice. In addition, we also want to express our sincere appreciation to the families of our board members who give up valuable family time when board members are away from home to conduct district business, and we'll meet them a little bit later. Tonight we have a very special presentation for you by the students, art students at Sullivan, our newest elementary. And at this time, I want to introduce Will Cadilla, the art teacher at Sullivan, who will tell us a little bit about the special gifts that were made by his talented students.
Good evening, everyone. I would like to thank our students and parents first for letting them come to this meeting and present their gifts. I want to thank you so much for that. And I just want to share with you as well, for these board recognition gifts, we have seven just amazing art students here who did such a wonderful job. And I told them, you guys were chosen to give these gifts to our wonderful board here. And I want to also say this, that I was so honored that my students at Ann Sullivan Elementary were chosen to do this. It's not just a tradition, it is an honor to be able to be here and present you these gifts as well. These wonderful students worked very hard on every unique piece of artwork. I made sure that, like, when they asked me, you know, what are we gonna make? I said, well, use your imagination, because that's why we're here, right? To have these students use their imagination. Art is one of the most amazing classes in my perspective. Obviously, I'm biased, but it's one of the places where they get to learn not so much about the outside world sometimes, although we do a lot about that. One of our primary goals is that they learn about themselves and they're able to express themselves. It's a wonderful, wonderful thing. So let me go ahead and move on here. Let me tell you a little bit more about how these students created their pieces. Like I said, I wanted them to use their imagination. And sometimes those, you know, students will come up to me and they'll say, well, what should I do? I go, well, what do you love? What is your passion in life? What gets you motivated? And, you know, we start using clay, and all of a sudden you see their whole personality come out. And that's when you really, really are able to, in that classroom, build that key component of relationships with students. And that's why we're all here, right? It's relationships. It's not just numbers, although those are important. It's not even just the artifacts. It's the relationships we build every single day in our community. That's the most important job that we have. So I'd like to also say thank you so much. When you were planning Ann Sullivan Elementary, you gave us not one, but two kilns in the school. And that's an amazing thing to have a fully functional ceramics program in our school. Many schools don't have that. We are so immensely blessed there. And the kids come to me and they're like, really, our projects get hotter than lava? I go, yes, lava's at about 1,700 degrees, and your projects were fired at 2,000. They're a little cooler tonight, thankfully. But they get to learn so much chemistry and science and history through these projects as well. We talk about the molecular structure and how it changes inside the kiln, how it drives off the water, and how the different compounds change. So now they won't absorb water, and they are much harder now. So we get to work those into our lessons as well. And so we fired them twice in our kilns, one a bisque firing and then a glaze firing. And they're just so enamored by the fact that you put on the glaze and you take it back out of the kiln and it changed colors. How did that happen? Again, we're able to work in more science into our lessons. So I can go on all night, you could probably tell. But nevertheless, I just hope. We all hope, and we just hope you enjoy these gifts, because you mean so much to us. We know that sometimes I reap all the rewards as a teacher, all the hugs and high fives and little fist bumps. But you're the ones in the background making sure that we can do that every single day. So from the bottom of our hearts, thank you.
Thank you, Will. And now we're ready for our special presentations. The students will come forward with the gifts for each of the board members when I call their names and the name of the school board member to receive the gift. And board members, we'd like you at this time, if you'd like to introduce, if your families were able to be here tonight, we would like you to introduce your families when you're presented your gift. First, to honor Board President Kristen Tassan, Ruby Harrieta. Would you come forward with her special gift?
Yes.
To honor Board Vice President Jason Burdine, Marquise Kayada will come forward with his gift, and please remain standing with Mr. Burdine.
Here with me this evening is my beautiful wife, Andrea, my daughter Michaela, and my son Blake, and once again, without them, I couldn't be up here. I love all of you, and thank you for your support.
To honor Board Secretary Addie Hilliger, Raya Curian will come forward with a gift for Ms. Hilliger. Board Member K.P. George, Macy Scarborough will come forward with a special gift for Mr. George. To honor Board Member Grail James, Ethan Munoz will come forward with his special gift for Mrs. James. To honor Board Member Jim Rice, Issa Victor will come forward with her special gift for Mr. Rice.
This is beautiful. We like this more than any family administration can give. My wife is working, so he's got to pay for it.
And to honor Board Member Dave Rosenthal, Omar Barakat will come forward with his special gift for Mr. Rosenthal.
Thank you all, and thank you very much. I appreciate it.
like to take a few photos. And in conclusion, we want to recognize the parents of these student, talented students and their principal and, again, their art teacher. Could y'all please stand so we may recognize you? And Dr. Dupree, I turn the program over to you.
Thank you, Nancy. Before we conclude this section, I think it's appropriate for me to make a couple of remarks because it is Board Appreciation Month, and these seven folks are my bosses. So I want to make sure I go on the record expressing appreciation publicly, annually, at least once annually. No, truly, we spend so many hours together. We spend, the countless emails, countless phone calls, all the time we spend meeting, and I have to say, just like Will, the teacher, said, I feel the same level of support every day from this board. And not all superintendents can say that. So I want to thank each of you for what you do every single day to support me, to support our team, because collectively we're all here, Will, for the teachers who are here for the students. And that's the bottom line. And this board never, ever forgets that students are what we're all here for. And that's why it's a pleasure for me to work in Fort Bend ISD with each of these seven trustees. As I thought about what I wanted to say tonight, a quote came to mind that I read for the first time back in 2013. Bloggist Seth Godin wrote it on the day Nelson Mandela died. It talked about changing the world. So I wanted to share this with the board because I think it is perfect for the occasion as we honor our trustees. It says, for those that seek to make a change in the world, whether global or local, one lesson of life is this: you can. You can make a difference. You can stand up to insurmountable forces. You can put up with far more than you think you can. Your lever is far longer than you imagine it is, if you choose to use it. If you don't require the journey to be easy or comfortable or safe, you can change the world. So we're happy to celebrate you. I want to thank our students for the hard work they put in and for being here tonight. But just know you are appreciated from me, from all of us. Thank you for all you do, all the hours you put in, all day, every day. Thank you so much. And that concludes our recognitions.
Well, that was very nice. I want to say again, thank you to the students who made our lovely boxes, and to all the parents for being here. Thank you all very much. We really appreciate it, and we can feel the support. I know I speak on behalf of the board when I say we can feel the support, and thank you, Dr. Dupree, for your words. Very kind, and I think we all feel the same way. Our team of eight is truly a team. So now we have to move on to all the boring stuff. After that, so first up on our information items, we're gonna, audience items are next, yes. Commissioner James Patterson, thank you, sir, for being here this evening. Ms. Helliger will keep the time for you. Yes, sir. Yeah.
ladies and gentlemen, board, first thing is, if you've been a teacher and a principal, an assistant principal, and you have to come to board meetings, it is not a good thought in your mind. I will tell you up front, it still does that to me, to come before the superintendent, especially when the superintendent starts making fun of the fact you're wearing your tie. You know, as if I don't wear one all the time. I will tell you that it's always an honor because way out on the end down there is a young man that we went to Dulles High School together. He will tell you he was not in the same class I was in. He just happened to be a student when I was assistant principal. And there's others. Want to thank you from my family and from myself for the honor that you bestowed on us by naming elementary school number 50, James Patterson Elementary School. I couldn't be here the night you did, but I want to tell you how much I appreciate it, and our family appreciates it. I've met Ms. Bruin, and she's somewhere hiding back in the crowd way over there. If you will please stand up. Met Ms. Bruin, and with her enthusiasm and excitement for what the difference she can make, the faculty that she's going to be able to hire, the staff that she's going to be able to have around her, and with the support of the central office administration, I know that it'll be a wonderful school that the community will be proud of and will be able to support forever and always. And I hope that you didn't start till now. guys, I just have to tell you that I didn't know there was going to be board appreciation tonight, but from my opinion, the success of our community is absolutely a direct proportion to how good our public schools are. You make the difference in our community. You make it what it is. The mayors and city councils, county commissioners get credit for all that, but you make the difference. You make the difference by being here, and there's no community service that gets as little of credit and as much grief as you get, and we appreciate you more than you can ever imagine. I want to say a special thanks to Ms. Tassin because she's taken the challenge of challenging one of our state senators on his attitude about public education, and we're behind you if we can help you in any way. But again, I just want to thank you for what you do. I will try to be supportive in any way I can, always, of all of our schools, but one of them might be a little special. So thank you so much.
Commissioner Patterson, would you mind stepping up and taking a photograph with the board? Do you mind doing that, Joel? Our next speaker is Tammy Campbell. Did she come in? There she is. See if that microphone's turned on for you. Go right ahead.
Madam President.
Ms. Helliger will keep your time, and she'll let you know when you have 30 seconds, but we're not going to start till you get the get it turned right, okay?
Gather here. Greeting, Madam President, Superintendent Dr. Dupree, and distinguished board members. It is a pleasure to join you all tonight, and it's going to be a pleasure for you because I'm not here to complain. I saw you up there, Doc. But I want to tell you how wonderful this district is. The partnership that we had with Rosa Parks Elementary, Lexington Creek, for the We Love America Healthy, Clean, and Green, which our distinguished board member, Addie Helliger, I did it, Helliger. Hi. It was outstanding. Dr. Rodriguez came and joined us, and the children got awards that never got awards before. We Love America, Healthy, Clean, and Green is about encouraging young people at a young age to take care of their environment, which is very important because they are not only taking care of the environment for themselves, they are taking care of the environment for the future, and we have to prepare them to do so. Now, when we look at young people, we look at them and think that we are the ones that are the ones to tell them what to do. But in fact, once they are taught, they teach their family. And you're more likely to listen to your elementary student than you are your high school student. I would like to thank Dr. Dupree, Dr. Rodriguez, our board member, Addie Helliger, Miss Christine Hopkins from Lexington Creek, and I'm going to let Miss Marcette come and thank you all and give the proper names for everybody that was involved. Thank you so much.
And on behalf of Rosa Parks, in absence of Miss Espedicueta, our principal, it has truly been a wonderful experience partnering with the Honey Brown Hope Foundation, integrating writing, community service, just an awesome job. And those calendars are beautiful, breathtaking.
30 seconds.
Okay, Lexington Creek. You can say just a shout over there from Lexington Creek. Miss Hopkins, please. Partnership is engagement, people, and we engage. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I believe Ms. Kaiser has the calendars, and we'll get them when we go into closed session. Thank you guys very much for bringing us those. Our next speaker is Carrie Washenfelder. Ms. Helliger, we'll keep your time and let you know when you have 30 seconds.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Good evening, President Taze and Dr. Dupree and members of the board. We've been talking about the children and how great they're doing and the initiatives that are going so well, and we've congratulated the board. And so now I'm here to speak some words about the educators. And one thing that Tammy said that I think is really important is that we want to preserve engagement. And then she said, we are engaged. And that's what I want you to consider when you look at the level three grievance that you're going to look at and the recommendation from the hearing officer. This may seem to you that it's all about receiving a grievance late, but I'm here to say that this is more about that. In the spring of 2016, we first heard that the district was going to add 20 minutes to our teacher schedules. And at that time, it was confirmed in the spring that that is what would happen. At that time, there was a hue and cry all through the district. 20 minutes, what is this 20 minutes about? And then we discovered that this would be added, and no one knew when, no one knew where, no one knew who was going to be involved, who did it include, who didn't it include, and why, most importantly, am I teaching 20 more minutes without extra pay? So looking back at the records, we had found at Christmas that the teachers had had less than 2 weeks to consider the proposal that was being brought forth by the administration. And so we filed a grievance on behalf of our 2,000 members for a decision and a discussion, more importantly, that's what we were asking for a hearing to discuss why we were adding 20 minutes, was this necessary, and even more important, were there other answers? Were there other kinds of decisions we could reach? Could we collaborate on this to find out what was the exact problem, why did we have to add 20 minutes, and what were those possible solutions that we could add? The grievance was postmarked appropriately, but due to the vagaries of our post office here in Sugar Land, I love Sugar Land, but I could have walked the grievance faster than it was delivered here to the school building. And it came up 4 days after the allowable date.
30 seconds.
And the district decided not to hear the grievance. Though, for the last 10 years, they have gone on the postmark to determine if a grievance was timely filed. I'm saying it was timely filed. And furthermore, it's time to listen to our educators and their concern about how we're using this 20 minutes, now 15 minutes,
thank you,
in their day. Thank you for listening.
Thank you.
Thank you for being here, Ms. Washenfelder. Our next agenda item is our information items. And first up is our recognized law enforcement agency accreditation.
Thank you, Madam President. We're exceptionally proud of our police department, so I'm going to turn it over to Chief Ryder, David Ryder. What's that?
Chief Gott.
Oh, Chief Gott from, he's going to introduce himself, but he's here as a guest to recognize our outstanding police force. Chief?
Chief, I think your microphone may not be on.
There we go. Okay, there we go. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
All right. Anyway, Superintendent, members of the board, and citizens of Fort Bend Independent School District, good evening. My name is David Gott. I'm the Chief of Police of Hedwig Village and an active member in the Texas Police Chiefs Association. I'm honored this evening to be representing the Texas Police Chiefs Association recognition program. The TPCA is an association made up of over 1,100 professional law enforcement executives throughout the state who are dedicated to improving the delivery of police services. I'm here to present the Fort Bend Independent School District Police Department a certificate of recognition for achieving compliance with Texas law enforcement best business practices. The Texas Best Practices Program is an accreditation program that has 166 challenging standards for Texas law enforcement. These standards address the full range of law enforcement operations, such as use of force, protection of citizens' rights, vehicle pursuits, arrest, search, and seizure, and property and evidence management. This program has become the new gold standard for professional law enforcement in Texas, and it's a voluntary program. No one forced the department to participate. About 2 years ago, Chief Ryder and the Fort Bend ISD Police Department began the process of proving its compliance with these difficult standards. They had to prove their compliance to well-trained independent assessors. Speaking from experience, I can say with confidence it's not easy to comply. The agency had to do a complete audit of all its policies, its procedures, training, and operations in order to meet these standards. The process culminated in November when two trained assessors, police chiefs from other parts of the state, made an on-site inspection of the department. These assessors interviewed the staff, inspected the facilities and operations, rode with field officers, and they ensured compliance with each and every standard. Their report was then sent to the recognition committee, which is comprised of 9 serving police chiefs from around the state who reviewed the report and voted to award recognized status to the Fort Bend ISD Police Department, and that vote was unanimous. The recognition program assures this board and the clients of Fort Bend ISD that your police department is operating in a manner that reflects the current best practices of Texas law enforcement. The certificate we present tonight is a symbol of professional excellence. However, the real value of the program is a process they went through to attain it. Your police department has proven to trained and independent assessors that they are one of the best in our state. There are currently over 2,400 law enforcement agencies in Texas, but only 133 have achieved recognized status. So this evening, we are officially recognizing Fort Bend ISD Police Department as 132nd recognized agency in the state of Texas. So Chief Ryder, if you can come up. Certificate. And this is from the Texas Police Chiefs Association Foundation. It says, to all that see this certificate, know that the Fort Bend ISD Police Department, having fulfilled the necessary qualifications and mandatory requirements of the Texas Police Chiefs Association, Texas Law Enforcement Best Practices Recognition Program, by voluntarily proving their compliance with the Texas Law Enforcement Best Practices, the Texas Police Chiefs Foundation Board of Directors does hereby award this Certificate of Recognition, and it was actually effective the 17th of November, 2016. It's good for you. Congratulations, Chief.
Stacy, can we get let the board get a picture with the police officers that are here as well? If you guys will join me in front of the dais.
Chief Ryder, were you going to make any comments?
Yes, please.
Would you like to?
We'd like you to.
Please, Chief.
You've only got four printed out pages there.
Am I limited to 3 minutes?
No,
sir. No, thank you.
Yeah, I was going to say you get two. 90 seconds.
I'll speed through this. First of all, before I get started, I also want to recognize the board for January. Board Recognition Month. You guys are fantastic to us, and thank you for your support, and congratulations on your being a finalist for the 2017 HEB Excellence in Education Award. You deserve that. You know, receiving this honor is, it is an honor, but it's not just for me. It's all the personnel behind me, our entire department, and I think our district shares in this. This is something that the police worked on, but it's also dispatch, it's also life safety systems, it's also communications, it's records management, it's property and evidence, it's crossing guards. Every single facet of our department was involved in this, and so that's very important. I want to thank the Board of Trustees and Dr. Dupree for your support. You always support us, give us what we need to do the job, and allow us to think out of the box when we do it. So thank you for that. I want to thank the men and women of the department behind me and everybody who couldn't be here. Without them, this isn't possible. They had to make sacrifices, changes. I know a lot of times they think I'm nuts the way we issue policies and visions and things like that, but they go along with it and it works out. And we're so I'm so thankful for all of y'all. The students, the staff, the community, thank you so much for your support, and my family in attendance, my wife Jody and Haley and Hayden, thank you. Like Chief Gott said, this best practice recognition program began in 2006, so it's about 10 years old. It is voluntary. There are 166 best practices, and it's not an easy process. Examples of some of those best practices include, but they're not limited to, professional standards and conduct, training, records and record management, use of force, law enforcement operations, communications, and property and evidence management. Proofs for each one of these have to be submitted. And it's not just good enough that we say we do it. We have to show proof that we do it through training records, through documentation. And then once all of those are accepted, then we have an on-site evaluation team. Our team, the initial team, was scheduled to be here for 3 days. They left in a day and a half. And so I think that says a lot about how prepared we were for this process. So I'm excited about that. There's over 250 school district police departments in the state of Texas, and we're number 5. To get this, so pretty excited about it. This is a 4-year award, and so we'll have this for 4 years, but annually we're gonna have to submit documentation to show that we're in continual compliance. Every 4 years we go through a full audit again. And my wife reminded me that Facebook, I don't have Facebook, but she said that Facebook sends reminders about what happened on this date, how many years ago. And we actually moved to Fort Bend 7 years ago today. So this is kind of cool. But this has been a goal from the beginning, but we had challenges. And I was talking to Dr. Dupree about this, and we had a 10-year-old policy manual when I started here. It had not been touched in 10 years. We had no personnel files, loose sheets of paper stacked on top of a file cabinet that should have been in a personnel file somewhere, and they were just laying loose. Vehicle and equipment issues. There's officers back here that drove vehicles that the check engine light had been on for so long and the car never got fixed. They just put black electrical tape over the check engine light just so they didn't have to see it. Training issues. Officers were finding their own training to go to because the department just didn't support the training efforts. And there was, but the main thing, there was really no connection with our community.
Right.
And we've heard that before tonight about building relationships. The Hockey Hall of Famer Wayne Gretzky said that you miss 100% of the shots that you don't take. And so we decided to take a shot with this. And so we created a family atmosphere. We work together as a team. We updated our policy manuals. It's online, so we don't have to kill a bunch of trees, printing it out every time we change something. We have a personnel file system that's in place. We have new vehicles, and we have plans in place to keep the fleet updated. We provide every officer with 80 hours of training, which quadruples the minimum number of training hours required by TCOL. But most importantly, we began building positive relationships with our students, staff, and our parents, and our community. Evidence of that, we have officers that feed families at Thanksgiving, and they just did that on their own. They put on the uniform, they represent the department, and they go out in the community and they partner with community members and feed families. We've had officers that go on shopping sprees at Target with Missouri City Police, and they identify students that are in need that otherwise probably wouldn't get gifts for Christmas. We just really changed the culture. We had a family that was evicted from their home. They had 5 students in our district, and they were evicted. They didn't have a place to live, and no other agency in this county would help them because of just that circumstance. And our police chaplain put them up in a hotel, and our officers bought meals for them and provided transportation for those students to get to school because they were out of their school bus route at that time. Some of our officers recently used the $500 bonus that the district gave them to go buy school clothes and shoes and school supplies for elementary school kids. These are the changes that we're making. And that's not law enforcement. That's just something that comes from the heart. Mm-hmm. And so I'm very proud of them for that. So we hope that this award, and this is a journey. It's not a destination. We're not done just because we got this. This just opens new doors. And so we hope this award shows our community and our students, staff, and parents that we're committed to serving them with the utmost integrity and professionalism. Thank you.
In conclusion, on this aspect, this part of the report, I would just say it is a privilege to work with a leader like Chief Ryder. I've got full trust and confidence in his ability, and you see evidence of that in his remarks he made tonight. Because I know there's five school districts. You said we're number five. I'm going to say we're number one.
Yes.
Because we've got the best chief. We've definitely got the best officers. Every single position is filled with quality people, whether it's dispatch, whether it's records, whoever it is, everybody in that department is quality and dedicated to serving the students. But that all begins at the top. So thank you, Chief, for your efforts, for your leadership, and to each of you officers, because it is your hands, your feet that are representing this district and this community. When you see those kids, they see Fort Bend ISD, and they see love, care, compassion, and concern. And we appreciate that because they know they're safe, but they also know they get a whole lot more out of you than just safety. So thank you to each of you, and thank you for being here tonight.
Thank you, Dr. Dupree. And Chief Ryder, I'd like to start by saying, because I'm sure the board members have comments, but I think that your comments tonight show your heart. And that is evident not only in how you lead, but in how all of these fine people that are sitting in this boardroom tonight carry out their jobs every single day. And our students feel it as a mother of three, I know. I encounter officers on a regular basis, and you can tell what leadership is like in this district. And I think that this is a great honor, and I agree with Dr. Dupree that we are number one. And I'm glad that someone has recognized what we already knew. So thank you for all your work. Thank you to all of you. And I'll ask now if any of the other board members have comments. Mr. Burdine.
There's been a lot of nice things said about you all, and I just wanted to say thank you again for your heart, and thank you for your leadership. And once again, you're here to keep us all safe, but you do an excellent job of educating our students, and I can't thank you enough for that, because that's what the business we're in here. So thank you all very much. You mean the world to us, and we're always here for you.
Mr. Rice.
Chief, we appreciate you. And when you related your story, it reminded me of a story I heard years ago about a fire department that won an award for being the best fire department in the nation. And I was intrigued by that. I wanted to know what kind of equipment they had, what kind of training they had. But they won the award not because of how many fires they put out, but of how many fires they prevented.
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes.
I just wanted to... I was just talking to one of the officers before. I was just saying, you know, when I went to school, there was no police officers in school. And last 3 years, I was able to interact with a number of our police officers. And I cannot stress enough just you mentioned. And I always felt a family atmosphere and they're caring. And I always felt that so much into my heart. And our children are very lucky to have you and also your force. And they are, I'm sure we all, Fort Bend ISD at large, is very thankful to your effort. Thank you.
Mrs. James.
Sorry, I didn't see you. Well, I just want to say thank you, Chief Ryder, and thank you to all of your department. The words that echo true for me are student-centered, and I know that you feel that in your heart because everything you do is about and for the students, and you lead your staff and your department in that way, and we as a board appreciate that because we're student-centered also, and what we do is for the students of our district. And thank you for taking that concept from the boardroom to through your leadership to all of our schools and to our classrooms, and thank you for being the leader that you are and for all your effort in leading your staff to put together all the necessary parts of this award so that you can be recognized, and we appreciate you and we appreciate all the effort involved. So thank you.
Mr. Rosenthal.
I'll be brief. Thank you and congratulations.
And Ms. Heliger.
I definitely want to say thank you all for all the work that you all do, for your leadership. Jim Rice, did you know he was a Boy Scout leader as well? He's a Boy Scout leader too. So, you all have a very difficult job to do. And it's about building those relationships with those students. And, you know, for a parent who has a child that's very active.
In the community?
Yeah, very active, you know. It's to all the kids that come across any of you all, that relationship that you all build with them is everlasting. So when there's something that a challenge that does happen with those children, they know that they can trust you, and that's what's the most important. So keeping our students first. So we once again appreciate all the work that you do, and congratulations again. Thanks.
Thank you, and I believe Chief got left already, but we want to thank him for being here and for presenting that award for us, and again, thank you all for being here and keep up the good work. Now, Steve gets to give us a budget update. Follow that.
That's the idea.
We are going to work on compensation. Thank you for that that rousing introduction. So here we are again. It is warm. You're right, Dr. Dupree. But anyway, no, thank you, Ms. Tassin, members of the board, Dr. Dupree. Dean is going to be joining me up here in a minute. But we do want to walk through where we're at from a budget perspective. So you know, here we are again, our annual odyssey starting in January. It's going to be a very interesting year, especially because of the budget session, or the legislative session. So let's get into it. We'll give you a bit of an update there, talk about some of our major variables, what we're focusing on, how we think we're going to try to make ends meet, show you some of our initial projections for 16-17, and then our timeline. So this is a quote from Glenn Hager from October 2015. He could have done the same quote in 2017. I met with him personally and talked to them for about 20 minutes in November when I was at a conference, and that was just a little bit before obviously they released their revenue estimates. But what he's trying to balance is that putting together a number that is realistic, but it's not too conservative because people complain. But then if it's too high and they don't meet that, then people complain. It's a difficult business to be in.
Steve, before we get into the details, I'm going to, if there is anyone that would like to exit.
Oh, that's okay. You're
please.
You guys aren't offend me. It's just going to be like 2% less.
No, we have the final say in that. So I'm going to go ahead and let, you don't have to sit here for it. We understand. We'd love to have you stay. Yes, it does. You can feel that.
Oscar's working on it.
Thank you again.
No, don't push anything.
Yes. Dr. Dupree wanted me to make you stay. I just want to say that for the record.
Oscar, are you getting this cooled off up here? Okay. This says unoccupied over here, so.
Not true.
Grail wants to start pushing buttons. I said don't push buttons.
I was going to take charge. That's all I'm saying.
Yes. Look out. Okay, thank you, Mr. Bassett.
No problem. Hopefully that'll help cool the room down a little
Maybe.
Bit.
Okay. No offense to the officers.
So this is the state's revenue slide, and Medina got it from a source, and so obviously we're not going to go through all of this. The main point is that the revenue estimate initiated by the comptroller is $2.9 billion less than what was set for the same for the biennium before. The major issues there, I mean, sales tax, which makes up almost 54% of the budget, those numbers are down overall. And then obviously everything related to oil has come in well below projections. So what this means for us is it is going to be a tight year. Okay, what he told me back in November is, you know, he was confident there was going to be enough state revenue to be able to handle student enrollment, you know, statewide, and for there to not be a cut to education. And so and we've certainly seen that with regard to what the initial budget bills have been put forth by the legislature. So some of the main points, though, is that out of the last biennium, whenever they set up things and had the vote on Proposition 7 to divert new state revenue to highways, that is something that is going to constrict what the state is able to do in future years. I'll have a graphic for that. I asked him about, you know, because this was after the election, I asked him about, you know, how he felt about things with regard to the Trump administration and their push for energy independence, you know, for us to be relying only on ourselves, which will really help the state of Texas. He's very optimistic about what the impact will be to the state of Texas, but he didn't see that really, you know, impacting this biennium in a major way, maybe in the second year, but he wasn't prepared to change his numbers based on that. So anyway, you know, again, our main strategy is to try to keep, you know, the property value growth in the foundation program funding. So here's just a graphic of the diversion of highway revenue. You can see over on the left that the scale's in billions. And so the comptroller's number is in the yellow, that higher number. The one below that is originally what Mo Casey and Associates were thinking that he was going to come in with. So he actually came in a little bit more aggressive than what they were originally projecting. But you can see for either one of those projections, if you have that $2.5 million going down and then going up in future years, you can see that impact. So there's been a lot already happening in Austin, over 200 bills already filed pertains to education. There's been a lot of talk about the finance formulas. Just today, the Senate put together a subcommittee for school finance where they're going to invite folks to come in and talk about their various plans. That should be interesting. Again, you know, there's been a lot out there about school choice being a priority in the Senate. A lot of discussion about property tax reforms, and so we'll see how that goes. And then also some bills, you know, including one of our own senator related to the extension of the ACOTAR, which is the additional state aid for tax reduction. And so, you know, again, what that pertains to, it pertains to the 200-plus districts in the state who have had such a high target revenue that was set back in 2006 that their number was so high in comparison to all the other districts that the state funding formulas in the past, over the past 10 years, hasn't caught up to where they're at. And so it is true that under current law, they will be cut, and some of them severely, in the next biennium. And so you can look at that a couple different ways. You could either have sympathy for them in terms of, you know, having a cut, but these are also districts that have known about this for over 6 years. And so they knew this was coming. I know many of those districts have stocked money away, but some of them haven't. So we'll have to see how that impacts the budget this coming year. The state share formula funding has declined over time. So you can see, and this is statewide. These are statewide numbers. And you can see, even though, overall the state funding, the dollar amount itself, you know, hasn't gone up even with the enrollment. And so you can see significant changes in that state percentage going down. But right now they're projecting to finish the second year of the biennium at 34.8%. So just as a reference, in 2016-17, our the state share for our budget, our own budget in 16-17 is 37%. And so, which is, you know, definitely down from where it's been over the past few years. But this is on a statewide basis. Okay, so Ms. Edgar's going to come up and start talking about the some specifics about the budget, and I'll chime in as needed.
Good evening. So in looking at budget projections for the district for 17-18, there are many variables that can quickly change the forecast by many millions in either direction. Some of the most prevalent are the comptroller value. So remembering that the formula looks at prior year comptroller value, and that's a value that we'll be getting at the end of this month, so just really in a few days, and then that variable will be locked in. That's going to drive a lot of what's happening in the funding formula for fiscal year 17-18, and that's how it compares to the central appraisal district value, which we'll receive at the end of April. Until then, we use our forecasting tools to project an estimate. So some other things that are more basic are enrollment growth and attendance, both general and weighted. Free and reduced counts also lag a year, so next year's state comp ed funding is based on this year's free and reduced counts. And then some things out of our control include outcomes from the 85th legislative session, either good or bad. And along those lines, any changes to the funding formula, of which, you know, as Steve said, many models are being looked at. Okay, so one of the basic variables mentioned is enrollment. We're currently projecting the addition of approximately 1,200 students based on our demographers' moderate growth scenarios. So for currently 16-17, we budgeted 74,111 students, and as of the end of the third 6 weeks, we're up 186 students in our projections. Now, the numbers that you're seeing on the slide actually represent PEAM snapshot, so for comparison purposes, we always use a PEAM snapshot date, which is the last Friday in October. The end of the third 6 weeks is the day before winter break. So that's a more recent number. This next slide illustrates historical property values, with the green bars representing total taxable value, and then the line separating existing value growth in blue from brand new value in orange. Approximately 25% of property value growth is coming from new construction. Moving on to our initial focus in the development of the 17-18 budget, one of the main discussions has been surrounding retaining and attracting best-in-class talent. The budget team's been working very closely with human resources, and we will be bringing a comprehensive compensation package forward at the February board meeting for discussion, with a focus on market leadership and campus staffing. Other priorities include a leadership development plan for principals and APs, which Mr. Spears will be discussing at the February board meeting. And then later on in the budget cycle, we'll discuss additional compensation elements to include a general pay increase, changes to stipend and equity, and possible changes to calendar days. So in order to make all of this work, we have many tools in our toolbox to assist us in closing any gaps in budget. I'll speak to a few of these in particular this evening, but some of the more impactful tools would obviously include a new funding formula or new money coming out of the 85th legislative session. But this visual is really to demonstrate that we have many options available depending on various outcomes as elements in the budget solidify as we go on in the cycle. The budget development process involves an ongoing and collaborative framework that includes discussions with our Budget and Compensation Committee, and that consists of a group of nominated delegates from departments and campuses, and they provide recommendations and feedback throughout the budget process. The budget team also presents and solicits input from principals and directors in our quarterly C-squared meetings, in teacher forums, and in the monthly Benefits Committee meeting, and also we have a monthly business breakfast, and we present regularly on budget in that meeting. One of the tools in our toolkit is the District Resource Allocation Team that was created last year. And they were formed to assist in the evaluation of programs and practices district-wide. The team consists of cross-functional leaders from curriculum to facilities to communications. And part of their charge is to identify funds that can be reallocated to critical areas in the district that are better aligned to support board and district priorities. Our enterprise division has been in place for a little more than a year now. There are many revenue producing opportunities underway, all of which they take up about 6 months or so to get firmly established with that revenue coming in through the pipeline. This graphic shows 800,000 or plus projected at year end, but approximately 550,000 has been realized year to date. And this is an area that we're really proud of, and it's really got potential for some serious growth. So we discussed the opportunity of considering a two-penny tax swap. This would consist of reducing the interest and sinking tax rate by 2 pennies from 30 cents to 28 cents, and then asking taxpayers to agree to swap the 2 pennies to the M&O side, the maintenance and operating side. Doing this would raise $14 million in the general fund. So essentially, the tax rate would remain the same. We'd reduce one side, raise the other. The enormously beneficial thing in doing this is we'd not only benefit from a collections perspective, but it also in the way the funding formula works for golden pennies above $1.04. So it's beneficial on both ends, the state end and the collections end. So in essence, the board would adopt the appropriate tax rate, and the voters would be asked to ratify this action. We will be bringing more information to you in future board meetings as we monitor progress in the legislative session on this idea. So the planning for the anticipated shortfalls in 17-18 were initiated in 15-16, and $28.3 million was committed and assigned to allow us to navigate through anticipated financial turbulence. We don't know what the legislature will do. We may get some extra funding, we may not. But regardless, there are many different avenues to take that will assist us in closing any gaps. Our planned fund balance strategies represent only one of these avenues. So current projections for year end 17 are looking more favorable than expected, with enrollment and attendance both trending better than anticipated. As of our earlier estimates, we're looking at ending the year with about 768,000 to the good. And again, in a budget this size, things can change real quick. So our team is constantly monitoring all the variables and, you know, as things change. So that brings us to the timeline, which is it's somewhat more accelerated from prior years to allow us to get in front of the hiring process and to put us in a good position rolling into spring break. So in February and March, we'll be discussing compensation recommendations and then the essential staffing approvals, really, with the three new campuses. And we'll present more details on what that tax swap might look like. On April 1st, we'll have our talent draft, and then we'll also be bringing in the contract renewals. We'll receive those preliminary certified CAD values at the end of April, and that'll be another variable locked in. And then in May, we'll call the date for the budget hearing. Then in June, we'll conduct the hearing at the first meeting and adopt the budget at the second meeting, along with any final amendment, our final budget amendment. And with that, we're happy to answer any questions.
Thank you, Ms. Ecker and Mr. Bassett. Do we have questions from the trustees? Mr. Rice.
Yes. Thank you, Ms. Edgar. So I wanted to go over a couple of things, and Mr. Bassett, maybe you can help me. Every time I think I understand the budget for the state, I find out I have an imperfect understanding. The $104.87 billion is for the biennium.
That's correct.
So that's telling me that, okay, so annually we're 52-plus billion for the state.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Also, my takeaway is when I got on this board, the state share or contribution was about 48%. We were 52% local property taxes, 48% from the state. And I'm understanding you to say statewide that contribution is 34%. For Fort Bend, we're at 37%. So statewide, local property taxes are making up 66% of the revenue for school districts.
Statewide for 16-17, it's basically 60%. That's right.
60?
60.
How about for Fort Bend then?
For Fort Bend, yeah, then it would be 66. That's right.
For Fort Bend, it'd be 66%. So local property taxes make up 66% of our budget. Okay, and Ms. Edgar, did I understand you to say that we're up 180 students from at this point in time
From last year's projection, yes, that's correct.
More than last year's budget was based on?
Correct.
And
which is good for our budget.
Well, that's good, but, and did I further understand you to say that we would, you anticipate ending the year with $768,000 in the general revenue? That's not the fund balance, that's a surplus?
That's correct.
And how have we achieved that?
Mainly because attendance and enrollment are trending more favorably than we anticipated.
Okay.
And we did base our projections last year on low growth in anticipation of the slowdown in oil. This year, we're basing them on the most likely or moderate growth. So we went on that next tier.
And looking at your graph here, I see in 2010, which is when I first got on the board, the precipitous drop in local property values, which brought on the need for us to declare a state of financial exigency and also to RIF 400 teachers. We've had quite a drop from 2013 to 14, but, and you say we're going to get our CAD appraisal values in April?
In April. We'll have the comptroller value in a few days.
Do we, Mr. Bassett, what do you see with that? Does it look kind of flat or?
The comptroller value, frankly, I'm not sure what to expect on that. But we have what's our original estimate on that?
We're using 10.
Yeah, we have 10% in our initial numbers for 17-18. That's really the main reason why we're not showing you numbers for 17-18 right now. We will in February 6th when we get together, is that the CPTD number, which we'll get next week, is something that has significant impact on our dollars, and a 0.5% change in that percentage is really impactful by millions. In terms of our local values, I mean, what we're starting to base things, starting to project, and we will have as part of our debt service update, whenever we show you those numbers in February 6th, we're thinking that we'll be coming in at least 10% from a local value growth.
Okay. Now, you said something that I'm not sure I understand correctly. We have the local CAD appraisal, but then we also have something from the state?
Right. So every year there's two major numbers that, from a property value perspective, we have our own local value growth and that projection. But then we have the percentage that the state is going to use to claw back our growth, which and could potentially reduce our revenue on a per student basis.
Right.
That's based on prior year values.
Yes. And this is the veil, the opaque veil of ignorance that 99% of our constituents don't understand, that when tax values increase, the state claws back the delta the following year.
That's right.
And this is really why we cannot afford to ever lower the tax rate, and what we spend so much of our time and energy doing, trying to educate and inform our taxpayers. And that's never going to change until all of our constituents understand that and begin to make these same comments to our elected officials who enjoy being able to do this and talk about lowering taxes without having to suffer any of the difficult decisions that we make. Because just like the state of Texas, we have to approve a balanced budget each year, and whatever pain that comes with that, we have to bear and still get the job done. So, just a couple more questions on, so I'm understanding you to say you choose not to show us budget numbers at this point in time because we have two variables yet that, as you pointed out, Ms. Edgar, can swing in either direction millions of dollars. And so we're kind of in a holding mode until April, but
We're gonna show you our first pass at those at the February 6th meeting when we start talking about compensation, because in between now and that time, we will have the state number for sure, and that's a major variable. We'll also have conversation with Glenn at the appraisal district to get a feel for where he's at. You know, I've had conversations with him this time of year, every year since I've been here, and that gives me an idea of, you know, based on what he says at that time. Gives me a better feel for what we think the final number will be. So when we do get together next time, especially after we have that state number, we'll be able to put together our first pass at what we think the number will be, absent more information from the state from the legislative perspective. This is assuming we don't get any new money from the state. But we'll explain that in more depth when we show you those 1718 numbers in a couple weeks.
Okay. So you choose at this time to broach the subject of a tax swap, lowering the INS 2 cents and increasing the M&O 2 cents. And we can lower the INS because we get to keep the increase in the CAT appraisal value.
Yes, sir.
Okay. And Ms. Edgar, I heard you say that doing that could potentially yield an additional $14 million in revenue. But could you explain to me the golden penny thing above $1.04? Can you dumb it down for me?
So the pennies on the state side, the golden pennies above $1.04, we can go up to $1.06, and they're worth more than if we go to $1.07, if you will. If once we go to $1.07, then there's copper pennies, and they're worth less. So we yield less from the state. And in our situation, we've now entered Chapter 41, and actually when we hit that third penny, $865,000 would be recapturable to the state.
I see. So we can go up to $1.06. Those are considered gold pennies, which I kind of interpret that there's no filter on it. The state doesn't have put a filter on those. But when it gets to be $1.07, that's a copper penny, and the state gets an additional cut even on top of the clawback. Is that essentially it?
Yes, and it yields less from the state side as well. So not only do we have to pay recapture, we yield less for each penny.
So it's just not worth it going to $1.07.
We wouldn't recommend going to $1.07 or beyond.
Okay.
Until things change. But just to make sure everybody understands that the $1.05 penny, that fifth penny, you know, or that first additional penny that we don't have now, and then the one after that, those are golden pennies that would be worth what a penny is worth for Austin ISD. That's just the way the funding formulas work. They have Austin ISD as that standard. And so everybody's always looking to see, well, how much property value growth has there been in Austin? You know, what is that worth? They have to incorporate that into the funding formulas. But those pennies that we have from, you know, from $1, $1, $2, $3, $4, we have four golden pennies now. We would be looking to add two more.
And just today, the state, the Senate and the House both came out with a proposal to increase the Austin yield, which would actually make those pennies more valuable if that went through. So instead of $14 million, it could be $16 or $18 million,
mm-hmm.
depending on how that yield comes through.
One last question. If we were to consider the tax swap, I heard you say that would require, I want to make sure I understood you correctly, that would require a motion by the board to move forward, but that would be put to the voters. And when would that need to happen?
It definitely would happen. We would definitely have to go to the voters. Right now at this time, we're not confined to going on one of the uniform election dates. There are other opportunities in terms of, you know, having an election, special election in the August or September timeframe. But we can talk more about that as we get closer to it.
Very well. Thank you very much. Very nice presentation. Very informative. I apologize if I offended any of our local constituents. I know they're not aware of these things. But I don't apologize if I offended the state legislature, because they should know about this. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Rice. Do we have additional questions? Mrs. James?
Well, Mr. Rice, I think you covered a lot of topics with your comments and questions, so thank you for doing that on our behalf. I just have one clarifying question, and that has to do with this graph that you have right here up on the slides. You talked about and mentioned that our growth projections were based a certain amount on new construction versus increased, I don't know what the right phrase is, but value, increased value. So could you say whatever you said again so that I could remember it, please?
So we get increased property values two different ways. One way is existing property values increasing, and the other way is new construction coming on the roll. So we did this calculation last year, and about 25% of our new value growth is from new construction. And that's really high.
Yeah. Okay. So thank you. That was a number that I wanted to catch, is that approximately 25% of our new value growth is from new construction. So thank you for clarifying that. And then an additional question on the golden pennies. So the first 100 pennies are taxed at or receive value at a certain one rate. The next four, in our case, or six if we were to go to that, receive value at a different rate. Could you explain that one more time?
Okay. So for every penny that we have, whether it's on the M&O side or the debt service side, we're going to collect based on the values of our total constituents. And so that's around $3 million and change. That's how much a penny is worth for every penny. So every penny we collect on the M&O from a dollar, even if it's up to $1.06, we're only going to collect $3 million locally. The catch is the way the state funding formulas work and the way that they made the changes in 2006, those pennies from $1 all the way through $1.06, if you choose to go through those pennies, you will get the Austin value. So you'll collect $3 million locally, but then the additional amount will be state dollars, state revenue, okay? You know, so if we choose not to pursue a swap, when we have the ability to lower our debt service rate and to have a level tax rate for our constituents, then we would be leaving potential state money on the table. They would be, in this case, because the Austin pennies are worth more than double our pennies, you know, it would be more than a match for everything that we collect locally. Does that make sense?
Well, it did until that very last sentence.
Well, I mean, it's just, I mean, they're worth, you know, over $7 million now, and way be worth over $8 million. And locally, we're collecting $3 million and change.
And that's the 101 through the 106 in this case.
Yes.
In that.
That's
scenario.
Right.
Okay.
And so for every other school district that's gone beyond $1.06, there's many districts that are at $1.17. They're not getting that full value in those upper arts. It's more based on their local values.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mrs. James. So one of the things I want to say, since we're talking about the potential of the swap here, of at least considering it, I think it's going to be critically important how we communicate that to our community, because as Mr. Rice says, there are many constituents that do not understand how the funding works and how those pennies work, and the fact that not only that we would be doing a swap that would not raise the taxes that they pay, but that the two additional pennies that are swapped to the M&O side are worth double what they're actually paying for, or what we're actually collecting locally. So I think that's going to be critically important. I just wanted to make sure that we get out ahead of that, if that's something that the board decides needs to happen. I want to correct something on your one of your slides, on slide, they're not numbered, but on this slide here, because I had the pleasure of hearing our Lieutenant Governor speak at the Texas Public Policy Foundation a couple of weeks ago. And I'm going to quote a little bit of it for the benefit not only of the board members, but of everyone in this room and whoever decides to watch the videotape. The $104.87 billion is not the correct number. The correct number is $103.4 billion, because $1.5 billion is from last session, and we have a shortfall in health care. And so they will be taking $1.5 billion out off the top. And so we're going to start with $103.4 billion. So that takes us down to less than $52 billion per year. Our Lieutenant Governor also said that the state spends approximately 50% on education and 40% on health care, and they will find ways to cut education and health care. And that was stated as a fact. He also said that we are going to live within our means, and that local governments cannot have budgets grow at 8 to 9% per year. And he was referring to the
increasing appraisal values. And then he stated that budgets are growing because of the growing appraisal values, and this is taxation through evaluation without representation. And that the state is not capping the local school districts. And that's a quote. And so many of you may have read an opinion piece that I put out about a week ago, and those are the words that prompted that piece, because those are not the facts. That is not the truth. It is not. And as Mr. Rice so eloquently pointed out, and as you guys have pointed out as well many times, our budget is not growing 8-9% per year, and we are capped, and they are getting the benefit of the delta the year after it is collected. And so I just wanted to make sure that we all understand that we're not actually starting at the 104, and that we have some significant challenges this session with our state legislators, particularly in the Senate. I'd also like to ask, when we're projecting local values, when you guys bring us those projections next month, are we taking into account Lieutenant Governor Dan Patrick's vow to cut property taxes, for which the state is not constitutionally permitted to levy or control?
No, ma'am, we're not. We're showing things based on current law, and so we're not doing anything with regard to projecting any changes in value above and beyond. I know that ever since I've been involved in school business since 2003, every legislative session I've heard discussion about them capping appraisal values. You know, this our community's been paying almost 10% a year every year,
right.
And when that happens to you over and over again, it really starts to hurt, and we've heard people complain about it. And obviously, if there had been an appraised cap during that time, our folks would be paying less. But the fact is that the state is the one who's been benefiting that to the tune of billions of dollars every year. And so that property value growth over the next biennium is worth $3.6 billion. And so I don't see them ever putting any kind of cap like that, not on the school district taxes, because if they did that on the school district taxes, that in essence, they would be cutting their own budget. They might do something from an appraisal cap perspective on the other municipalities, because they operate it differently from us. But I know they've been talking about that every time since I've been around. And if you think about it behind the scenes, it's really just talk. I just don't see them doing something on the school taxes.
And we expect that not to impact our funding.
That's right. We expect that to not impact it. But the battle from my perspective, and this talking with, you know, the Equity Center, TASB and others, when we're talking about the formula, it is really, you know, what we're trying to do is we're trying to make sure that the growth in school property values, okay, the growth in property values statewide, and also the recapture amounts as they go up, get plowed back into the school system.
Education.
That's really what we're, you know, we're not asking for anything above and beyond that. But the state has been benefiting from that year over year, as you saw from that one slide. And so that's really where the battle will be. But when you talk to the average person and you explain to them and they see that, they're like, well, yeah, that property value growth maybe shouldn't go here because we're growing so fast, but it should at least stay within property value statewide, you know, with the schools statewide. And so when they hear that it's going to pay for other things, it definitely seems to bother them.
In other words, when we levy a tax as the school district and we say it's for education, it needs to actually be for education.
Yes, ma'am.
And not go into the general fund to be spent on other things as it is currently.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, I don't have any other questions. Thank you both very much. I appreciate it. Mrs. James.
I'd just like to say thank you, Mrs. Tossan, for attending that conference and hearing those words and recording them so that we could hear them. And thank you for your sharing your opinions and your comments with us and with Lieutenant Governor Patrick, so that he was clear and can be held accountable for his words.
Thank you, Mrs. James. Okay, do we have any other?
Yes. And I'll keep it short, but I would like to thank you too for that, Mrs. Tasson. I fancy myself a somewhat adequate writer of prose and poetry, but I must defer to the master.
You are still the master, Mr. Rice, I assure you. All right, thank you guys very much. We appreciate all your work on this very important part of our job up here. Okay, next on the agenda is our program evaluation update.
Yes, our Chief of Staff and Strategic Planning, Beth Martinez, is going to introduce the topic. I don't know if she's going to have help or not, but Beth's going to talk about the status of our program evaluation work.
Thank you, Dr. Dupree and board members. And I'll be providing a brief overview for you today, or a brief update for you on the program evaluation process that Dr. Megan Evans shared with you all at the May 2016 board meeting. And at that time, she explained the program evaluation process that we would be using this year and future plans for reviewing and revising and asking the board to approve policy BI Local, as well as performing two pilot program evaluations during the 16-17 school year. And that would be the evaluation for the Naviance program and that of VISTAs. And at that board meeting, you all as board members charged us with conducting and delivering program evaluations that are without bias, that provide a holistic view, and that can be used to make decisions that are based on data. And so as we moved forward in that process, those were three very important things to ensure that the way in which the program evaluations were being conducted and being able to deliver to you program evaluations that met those three charges. We started first with the review and board approval of policy BI Local. And so today, to date, we have also completed the program evaluation for both the VISTAs and the Naviance program evaluations. And we're taking a step back. We're kind of pausing and reflecting to ensure that when we deliver these two program evaluations to the board, that we are with confidence able to say to you that they are without bias, that each one of the program evaluations is provides a holistic view, and that the data that we provide to you can be used to make data-informed decisions moving forward. And so in order to feel confident in that and to make sure that these internal program evaluations, that the methodology and the approach used to conduct these program evaluations and the data provided to you, to us and to you, to make those decisions, to make sure that we can provide that to you with confidence, we are, as I said, taking this step back to engage with Hanover, which is an outside consulting firm that has provided research to us in the district, conducted lit reviews and other program evaluations, so that we can have them review and validate the approach, methodology, and data that was gathered during both of these program evaluations. Again, as I said, we want to be able to ensure when we present these to you that the approach and methodology and the and that all of the feedback from Hanover and the feedback gathered from our business owners within the district during these program evaluations, that we take that feedback and help to shape and inform and improve the program evaluation process moving forward, that we are able to make improvements to this pilot process that we have used thus far. We believe that in engaging with Hanover and receiving that third-party objective feedback, that we will then be able to come to you and present to those evaluations and not only give you the data that has been provided and that evaluation with regard to Naviance and VISTAs, but that we are also able to come to you and present lessons learned and improvements moving forward in our program evaluation process.
Thank you, Ms. Martinez. Do we have questions from the trustees? Mrs. James.
All right, so I heard you say that we're going to engage Hanover to sort of check out what we've done, review the evaluations, the processes involved in the product that we've developed. Do we have a timeline for what that might look like, or?
Yes, we do. They are currently working on both. They will be able to give us feedback on the Naviance program evaluation by February 15th and the VISTAs program evaluation by March 15th.
All right. And then is it your expectation that you'd bring those, you'd do another night like this and a presentation to the board on those?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, and just for clarification, when we're, you know, our goal is long-term, that we're doing some pretty regular program evaluations, and we have sort of a process in place. Do we have built into to the process someplace? Where built in the process is the goal setting? In other words, the intended outcomes. So, and let me just use an example. We have a software renewal on our agenda tonight to approve. And so from that, we might have an expected outcome or an intended outcome. How do we develop those? Where do those come from, and where are they included so that the board's knowledgeable, and then we can come back as an organization and reflect on that?
Thank you. That is a very, very valuable question, and a process that we have in place through our demand management office. And I'll use software as an example. When a software contract is initiated, it will go through our initial request form process through our demand management in program management. And that process has stakeholders from all of the divisions, including Dr. Evans. And so the intent of that is to vet that potential project and to determine if a project manager will be assigned, while at the same time having Dr. Evans there to initiate that, okay, how are we going to know if this is going to be successful, so that she can engage in the front end of that and begin identifying and associating metrics by which we will later in the process and throughout the process be able to determine effectiveness, in order to bring that back to the board with that and possibly a program evaluation information as well, if one is conducted, to provide that data to say yes or no in moving forward when we come for a renewal, for example.
Okay, well, that sounds excellent. And I guess what I would like to say is, let's think about, and I guess we'll see what Hanover brings to us and how they evaluate it, but one thought that occurs to me is, how do we tie that into the work that we're doing here? When we're approving something or receiving a memo about a particular product or program that we're going to use, how do we incorporate that goal and make sure it's tied to the board goals, not in a generic way like all children will reach their full potential, but in a specific, a more specific and defined way? And I just say that's kind of the thing that I'm looking for, because we want to try to figure out value of these things. And as we look at as we consider our budget and consider how we might have to tighten our budget sometime in the future, or in the very near term, that's the purpose for the program evaluation, so we can determine what is bringing us the most value versus what is a nice to have, what's convenient, et cetera. And so, you know, we have to have sort of a scale of things and somehow quantify that in a data-driven way. So those are my thoughts around it, and I'm sorry that we can't kind of dive into it tonight, but I'm looking forward to hearing back in the near term about the process.
Thank you. Thank you, Mrs. James. Do we have additional questions or comments? Thank you, Ms. Martinez.
Thank you.
We will now convene in closed session under the Texas Open Meetings Act, Government Code Chapter 551, under the sections listed in the agenda, and for purposes of private consultation with the board's attorney on any and all subjects or matters authorized by law. We are now convened in closed session.